I'm at the London EV Show. We're backstage with Sarah Slurman. She's from Elmtronics. So thanks for being with us today. You are one of our speakers.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for having me on the show. I was opening the first session this morning called Electrifying Your Community. So we needed to get that message across that now is a really good time to think about electrification.
Yes, so that's where you guys come in. So tell me a little bit about what you do at Elmtronics.
Well, thank you. Elmtronics is a national company. We're multi-award winning now as well. We are an EV, electric vehicle infrastructure installer, and we also run a software platform called Hubster, which you need to underpin all of that equipment and make it work for you.
Wow. Okay, so you deal with businesses directly or end customers?
Great question. Yes, we help the business community and large fleets. We operate some of the largest fleets in the UK.
Oh, wow.
Do you believe, as they move through their electrification journey, but also the homeowner. So we work with a partner called Easy Chargers, and they help to electrify the home.
Wow. Okay. So tell me, in the race to 2030, what more can we do to get people on board with adopting an EV?
Well, I've been giving this a lot of thought because ultimately, people aren't going to do it unless they want to. And
yes,
the want can come from different places. Some people feel really compelled since climate emergency, and even COP26 had a part to play in this.
Of course.
Where everybody wants to do their bit and to be making real consumer choices that benefit them and the environment. But more than that, I think people are starting to just realize that they're getting a bit left behind. You're going to have to start thinking about your next car or your next home. And even now with legislation being passed that all new build homes are going to have an electric vehicle charger, has really made people stop and think about what they're doing with their own cars. But we know that cars are exciting and people love them. They're a product, they're a symbol of status. Mm-hmm. And I think that could be one of the keys to unlocking that desire, is getting those vehicle manufacturers to produce vehicles that people want to drive, away from EVs looking weird. I remember trying to select a vehicle and my stepson didn't like the one that I wanted.
And which one was that?
I'm not going to name drop it. I feel terrible because taste is a strange thing. Well, I really liked it, so I didn't
Subjective.
Get it. Peer pressure made me not get it.
Oh, no.
Whereas now I see that flipping. You know, we were talking about the Hyundai 5, and people love that car. They want that car, and that's getting people talking.
Yeah, it is. Definitely. And again, Tesla, very exciting. I mean, I was interviewing somebody yesterday, an attendee of the conference, and he said, I just want a Tesla life. I want a Tesla home. And when you think about it, they have really created this kind of lifestyle brand around Tesla, haven't they?
They have, with the Powerwall and battery that you can have in your home to soak up that sun, and then the vehicle and the charging infrastructure. You're in the club then. You know that you're a Tesla driver. Everybody wants to hear about it. They want to ask you the questions about it. Mm. And it has a really nice sort of symbol of status as you go around. And I think all the brands are aiming for that. It's the number one aim. I'm not an electric vehicle expert, I'm an infrastructure expert, but I do love to see the public getting engaged through the vehicles.
Definitely. So in terms of infrastructure, in your opinion, what needs to happen in terms of building better infrastructure so that 2030 is this more seamless process and more people can enjoy an EV, and actually, even if they don't have off-road parking, they can still get involved with adopting electric?
Exactly right. 2030 is scarily close.
Very.
It's something that used to be 2050, and then it became 2035, 2032, and now it's 2030 for the phase out of what we call ICE vehicles, internal combustion engine vehicles. So traditional petrol and diesel will go.
Yes.
Now, we're going to need a lot more electric vehicle charging infrastructure, and it's going to take different shapes and forms. We cover the kind of back to base stuff, so fleet depot yards or your home or a destination like a shopping centre. Most of our customers are local authorities or people who own land. So it's really great that landowners are coming forward to say, well, look, I want to do the right thing. I want to be not only electrifying my fleet, but offering the public a chance to charge. Mm-hmm. And that's where the software comes in, because you simply see a charger, pull up, read it, QR code it, and then you're in. You can charge your vehicle at that charge point, and that's through Hubster.
That's interesting, because everybody's got their own different mechanism depending on where you charge, or if it's a fast charger or other things, but nobody really wants to have to do a lot of admin when it comes to charging the car. But there are some people that make you sign up or go on an app and download it and do all these other things. So can you just explain how your process works, say for example, from one of your public charging stations?
Yeah, my pleasure. So you arrive at the charging station and you will see a QR code with our brand, which is Hubster. And through Hubster, you can access other people's chargers.
Oh, wow.
So the next time you turn up to a different charger, you can swipe your card, and if it starts, then you know it's in the club. Now, of course, we send you information and tell you exactly which ones are. Mm-hmm. And I'm predicting we've got sort of 60 to 80% of the country covered now.
Wow.
Because we're working really close partnership with those headline names, you know, Osprey, who do the rapid charging at things like the pubs.
Yes.
So you can, without having to faff about with the next system, you can already mm-hmm. access it. And some great shout outs are deserved, like Octopus Juice, where we've all joined together and you can have the cost of your EV charging put onto your home energy bill. So you don't even touch
wow.
the cash, it goes onto your direct debit. So Hubster's part of that.
That's
network
really
environment too. So it's just about, it's called interoperability and roaming. It just means you as the end consumer or fleet driver shouldn't have to worry about where you're charging, because you should already have mm-hmm. access through a trusted provider like us. And it's sort of a, you can be a member for an entry-level fee. It's just £10 for the card.
Okay, so, and that's it? And not per month? Or
that's right, and then you wow. just pay for the energy you use. That's how it should be.
No, that is how it should be. So another question that we've got around infrastructure is accessibility. Mm. So how are people that maybe have accessibility needs going to be able to charge their cars, let's say, at a public charging space? Is there something that you're doing to help with that?
Yeah, really proud to have been part of the West of England Combined Authority project, which saw us put in some rapid chargers, and we were the first to dedicate a bay entirely for disabled use, because we realised that disabled vehicle users need more space, that's obvious. But what's been really interesting about the project is it's not just about disability and accessibility, it's about inclusivity.
Yes.
So anybody anywhere who has a mobility impairment or who perhaps doesn't like handling a massive cable should feel like there's an easy solution for them. And mm-hmm. silly things like putting the card reader high up so that you can't reach it, or the cable is heavy, is another common objection.
It is heavy
and you know, sometimes they don't engage properly when you put them back and they fall to the floor and smash. Well, that's your problem then, that's your infrastructure that's just been damaged. So it just makes sense to make the parking bay big enough for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And that's people with anybody who's got a wheelchair or a pushchair or shopping
yes.
or anything at all, to be able to throw that door open and find your charging cable. And I think a really good example is at Cribbs Causeway, which is a Bristol area. It's a big shopping centre, and they've been have had great foresight to remove some of the normal parking bays and put extra wide electric vehicle bays
that's
in.
Great.
And there's no reason for it other than it's the right thing to do.
Yeah. No, great. And I mean, I've been to a private rapid charger before, and I'm 5'4". I don't have any kind of physical needs in terms of being able to use a charger. However, I'm 5'4", and a lot of women are. It's like the average height of a woman. I couldn't actually see without standing on my tiptoes how much I was going to be paying. Like, who is using these? You know, not everybody's going to be able
and
to read that or
as
use
well.
That.
There's yeah. often language, and I've often said that the chargers are really exposed. You're standing there for not long. The user experience is probably 30 seconds, 40 seconds whilst
yeah.
you plug in and scan on. But you're in the rain and the wind, and that is actually a step backwards. Even fuel stations allow you to be undercover whilst
yeah.
you wrangle the energy
no,
into your
true.
Vehicle.
That is really true.
So that's what I'd like to see is as we get more and more electric vehicle charging infrastructure out there, thinking carefully about that user experience, because it's
yeah.
going to become mass. And I'd really like people to feel like they're safe and they can go and access a tea or a coffee or maybe go swimming or use the gym. Whatever it is, I want them to be using our infrastructure, our software, enjoying that experience, and maybe even injecting some economy into the local spaces that they've pulled up to.
No, that's great. And I really love everything that you've just said there. It's not, look, this is what we're going to do and people are going to like it and we're just going to do it our way. It's definitely sounds like people over profit in a way. It's about creating something that everybody can be a part of, and you said inclusive, didn't you? Which
I
is great.
Did, and I think that's a really nice phrase to use, inclusive, because you're not singling everyone out by trying to include them. It's just
yeah.
inclusive, it's inclusivity. Everybody is invited and everybody should feel like they're part of that, and that will naturally lead to profit because you're giving people what they want.
And a good experience, which they'll tell other people about, and so on and so forth. So how have you found the show so far, Sarah?
I've been delighted by the London EV show, because whilst we're in really testing times again with COVID,
yeah.
they've done absolutely everything they possibly could to make sure not only the speakers and guests feel secure, but also the exhibitors too. So they've spaced everyone out and you can really get a feel for the equipment. Everyone's wearing masks when they're not seated or eating or drinking, and we've all been asked to show our passes. So everything aside, the show's been great. Got a really broad range of exhibitors, massive amount of sponsors, which has made everything seamless.
Yes.
But what I like about the exhibitors this year is we don't have the same old, same old. There's some really innovative stuff down there.
Really innovative.
And watching the panel sessions and the debates, I can see that people are tuning in from around the world. And that's what London does, is it puts us on the map. And I think our responsibility now is to take all the learnings we've had from the multidisciplinary panels and implement what we've been told to do.
No, definitely. Well, thank you ever so much for sharing that with us. We're looking forward to watching your talk later. And yeah, it's been great to have you here and hope to see you again soon.
Well, thank you for having me. And I hope that we'll see London EV Show come back next year.
Yes, of course. Thank you so much.
Thank
Sarah.
You. Bye for now.